The next level, if we see, we have this bond pair plus lone pair, that means the total electron pair, if it is say 4, the most common example is CH4, right? I am not going to the hybridizational diagrams anymore, right? We have already drawn it. CH4 is very common. It is sp3, we know, and something looks like this in three dimensions, and we know the bond angle is 109 degree 29 minutes. Okay. Fine. Now what if we replace one bond pair with a lone pair? Now who is next to carbon on the right hand side of the periodic table? It's nitrogen. Now if you have nitrogen, then in ammonia, right, it forms 3 sigma bonds. It is again sp3 hybridization, right, and this forms 3 sigma bonds with 3 hydrogen, and this is the lone pair. Now what does this lone pair do? See, now we can draw it same way, no problem. Now we have a lone pair here. Again, the lone pair is only held by the nitrogen, loosely held, so it is much closer to the nitrogen. As such, it exerts some pressure, repulsive pressure, on the nitrogen hydrogen bonds. As a result, they contract toward each other because bond pair repulsion is lower. As such, this angle now decreases to 107 degrees. Okay. The effect is even more in case of what? Water, right? Where there is 2 lone pairs. The orbital picture, again, I am omitting it, but how it will look like now? We have replaced now this, there are 2 lone pairs, so they repel each other very much. As such, they now are more, I mean, forcing the oxygen hydrogen bond away from them, right? As such, these 2 bonds come more close to each other and reducing this to 104.5 degrees. Okay. So again, as in the previous case, here also you see in all the cases the hybridization is same, it's sp3, but the molecular geometries are different. In this case it is tetrahedral, this is trigonal pyramid, and this is V shape or bent. Okay, now what is the difference between tetrahedral and a trigonal pyramid? See, in a tetrahedron, all the apex are away, they are equidistant, right? They are all equal, these sides. But in a pyramid, right, this height is shorter, right? Suppose the tetrahedral would be like this, but it has come down here for trigonal pyramid, right? Due to the absence of any bond here, there is only lone pair. Okay. Now we go to the next level, that is number of electron pair, if it is 5. The classic example is PF5 or PCl5. Let me show one of the hybridization here. Here we have, say, 3s, 3p. Now d orbitals will come into picture of the hybridization. Okay. So in the unhybridized case, it is like this, right? As in the case of ammonia. But in excited state, this is in ground state, In excited state, it becomes okay. So now there are five unpaired electrons. So it can form five sigma bonds, and this is called sp3d hybridization, and forms five sigma bonds, right? Five sigma bonds it can form, giving rise to a structure of say p why it is called trigonal bipyramid we already considered. Okay. Now we are more interested in lone pairs, putting lone pairs and how they affect the geometries. Now the next element right to phosphorus is see sulfur. See, sulfur in ground state is like this, right? So d orbital is again vacant, 2, 3, 5. In say in SF4, sulfur in SF4. So by SF4 formula only we see there is a maximum of 4 sigma bonds, not more than that. So we need 4 unpaired electrons. Here also the hybridization is sp3d, but now we have one lone pair and 4, we can say for 4 sigma bonds with fluorines. Now a question arises. It was not the case as in ammonia, right? Or what is that? Water. Because all the bonds in a tetrahedral are same. Now the question arises, where the sigma bonds, the lone pair will be. You have two possibilities now. Okay. See, it can either be this one, a lone pair is here, or you can also put the lone pair here in the axial position. Which one will be the correct? Because both of them cannot be possible, because both of them different energies. See, in the case of this first one, what will happen here? Okay, last first one, see how many lone pair repulsion is there. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 bond pair lone pair repulsions. Fine. So 4 bond pair lone pair repulsion is there. In this case there is only 1, 2, 3, right? So nearest, because it will not repel which is 180 degree away, so it can be excluded. But though there is 4, out of these 4 only 2 are, I can write it like this, 2 bond pair up to 2 of them are at 90 degree and 2 at 120 degree. But in this case 3 lone pair repulsion are at 90 degree, right? Now this 90 degree repulsion at 90 degrees is much more fierce and much more energy rising than repulsions at 120 degree, because it is far away, right? As such, this is the most stable than this one. So this will not form because it has 3 bond pair repulsions at 90, bond pair lone pair repulsions at 90 degree, whereas it has only 2. Okay, so this will be the structure of SF4. And so we have a structure of something like this. Okay. Now what it is called? This is called the seesaw structure. And As such, this angle is not, sorry, this angle is not 180 degree anymore. This is lower than 180 degrees now, because due to the repulsion from this lone pair. And this is also lower than 120 degrees. Why it is called seesaw structure? Seesaw is what we saw in the parks, we see, right? So a two person if sits here, right, and they once come down, one this person comes down and it goes up, huh? It's like this. This is the seesaw. See, if you view it like this, right, it will look like a seesaw. That's why it is called a seesaw structure. Again, I repeat that the hybridization of phosphorus and hybridization of sulfur in both cases are same, and it is sp3d. Now in the same structure, if we have say two lone pairs, suppose we take the example of clf3, an interhalogen compound clf3. In this case, right, the structure is called T-shaped. Now see, the second lone pair also comes in the equatorial plane. Why? Because if this, the other possibility is what? It can come here also in the right. But in this case, the lone pair repulsion would be 90 degree. Here it is roughly or more than 120 degrees away. So there is less repulsion here, right? So here is less repulsion. So this will not be the case. This will be the shape. Now what is the shape? This shape called T-shaped. Just one more example here, right? You might have heard about this iron, triiodide iron, right? That why potassium iodide is not soluble in iodine is not soluble in water, but if you add iodine in a solution of potassium iodide, it is readily soluble. Why it is readily soluble? Due to the production of this triiodide ion, complex ion. This is has a structure linear. For the same reason, now it has three lone pairs and all of them occupy the equatorial position, because it minimizes the repulsion, lone pair repulsion, right? So it is linear now. So we just saw that four examples, right? PCl5, SF4, CLF3, and I3 minus. In all of them, the central atoms have the hybridization of sp3d, but the molecular geometries differ due to the presence of various lone pairs, right? We now discuss the molecular geometries of a system where the bond pair or the sum of bond pair and lone pair is 6. For an ideal case where there is all our bond pairs like SF6, I will just show the hybridizations quickly. Now I'll just draw the excited state directly, right? So it is sp3d2, because I expect that hybridization is already known, so I'm not going to details, right? So sp3d2, there are 6 unpaired electrons. All of the valence shell electrons are now unpaired. Now they can form 6 sigma bonds, and obviously they do so and forms a system like this, SF6. Okay, and the bond angles are 90 degree. So this is the ideal case, and we say that this is octahedron. okay, octahedral geometry, regular octahedral geometry. Now next to sulfur, or say is what, below sulfur in the next group we have bromine, right? Suppose we take the example of BrF5. What we have in the ground state, we have something, only one unpaired electron and with a vacant d orbital. So in the excited state, so one of the trick is, easy way to draw this kind of structures and find the hybridization is, just see what is the coordination number is 5 here, so you need at least 5 unpaired electron. So how you will have it? Just unpair these two, right? So you will have 5 unpaired electron. This forms 5, this is sp3d2, and these 5 forms 5 sigma bonds, and this is the our lone pair, right? Now if you have a lone pair there, the picture will look like, suppose now in comparison to the trigonal bipyramid, this is more simple. Why? Now you can put the lone pair anywhere, because there is nothing called axial and equatorial in a octahedral geometry, because all the 6 positions are equivalent. Now you can put it anywhere, right? You can put it anywhere, right? So this will give rise to a structure that we call a square pyramid. See, isn't it? It is like a square pyramid. Okay. Now, interesting is the entry of the next lone pair, right? The next lone pair, now we have choice. You can put the lone pair here also, where it is 90 degree high, and here it is 180 degree high. Obviously, by our previous discussions, it is very clear that the next lone pair will come 180 degree away from the first lone pair, right? Giving rise to a square planar structure. Example is XCF4, right? This is a square planar, and the hybridization is still same. It is sp3d2, right? In all cases the hybridization is sp3d2, but the geometries are different based on the number of lone pairs. Okay, now two more important things before we finish off. That you see that we already know that the multiple bonds do not affect the geometry, but they only occupy the accompany the single bond. Now where the multiple bonds will be positioned, right? If you say we have an example of SOF4, right? So it's like is double bond O is there, and 4 single bond with 4 sulfurs, where it will be formed. Now these double bonds are what? They occupy more space. Multiple bonds occupy more space than the single bonds. So they behave more like lone pairs. So as they take up more space, they will behave more like lone pairs. And in a geometry where we have seen the positioning of lone pair, we discussed just now that it will be axial or equatorial, it will be farthest away. So we'll follow the same rule and put those lone pair, multiple bonds farther away from each other, and where they can minimize the repulsion in this order, right? So multiple bonds repulsion is most, so they will be farther away from each other, then the multiple and single bonds, then this one. So clearly we know now SF4, if you see, it is not that complicated. If you just write down these orbitals. I have said that I will not show the hybridizations, but I think in most of the cases I am showing it. So sulfur in SOF4, so that is excited state, right? 6. Okay, so we have 6 lone pairs, but here one thing you must remember, that these 5 electrons form 5 sigma bonds, and these forms pi bond. As such, pi bonds will not affect the hybridization, neither the geometry. So it will have what? sp3d hybridization, and the geometry will be trigonal pyramidal, bipyramidal. Fine. Now the interesting thing is where to put the double bond. As in SF4, what we did? We have positioned the lone pair in the equatorial position. Here also we will do the same thing, right? We will position the double bond in the equatorial position, because it behaves almost, because it occupies more space and behaves similar to lone pair. Okay, and so this is about SOF4, and lastly this one about this 5 and 7 electron pairs. Suppose you have this PCl5 we just talked about, and this IF7 also, IF7, this is sp3d3. Here also the same problem is there. See, there are now 2 types of bonds, right? One is equatorial, one is axial. In all these cases, right, there are 2 types of bond length also. Equatorial bond lengths are the shorter. These are shorter bond lengths. These are equatorial bond lengths, shorter. And you see, these are axial bond lengths, which are longer bond lengths. See, in PCl5. Whereas same is the case for IF7 also. So yes, I think I give it lightly. These are shorter bonds and these are longer bonds. Okay. In all the other examples also, you see this SF4, same hybridization. We just saw ClF3, same hybridization, right? So one of the equatorial bond is shorter than the axial bonds. Why this happens? This happens because these equatorial bonds have more S character. More S character, so more electronegativity, so it pulls the electron more towards itself. Why more S character? For this, we will see that in the next slide, there is a rule. We'll see how, with an example, why it is used for, called Bent's rule. See, what it says, Bent's rule: a more electronegative substance prefer hybrid orbitals having less S character, and more electropositive substance prefer having more S character. Let me put it like this. See, PCl5, we have no problem, right? We are writing the structure. What about, say, this kind of compound? It is again, the coordination number is 5. The hybridization is sp3d, no problem with that. So phosphorus will have 5 coordination number like this. Now where to put this 4 fluorine? For this we have to see this Bent's rule of S character. Which is more electronegative? Fluorine. So electronegativity, fluorine is much higher than chlorine. So fluorine will go to the orbitals which have less s character, and fluorine will go to orbitals which has more s character. More s character. Right. We already in the other slide mentioned that the equatorial bonds have more s character. Why? Now see, this hybridization sp3d can be actually a summation of two things, sp2 and pzdz2. Okay, understood. See, sp2, why sp2? See, this is a what does sp2 give us? It give us trigonal planar structure, right? For BCl3, you remember we just discussed BCl3 trigonal planar. Now this is that plane, trigonal plane, right? This is the sp2, whereas the pz, so this is along what? The xy plane. This is the xy plane and this is the z axis then of the atom, and along this z axis we have these two orbitals pz and dz square. They hybrid to form another hybridization pz square. Okay, pd hybridization. Now as you see, there is no s character here, right? No s orbital in involved in this axial bonds, whereas this sp2 is involved in the equatorial bonds. Okay, so the less electronegative element will go to a bond which has more s character, which is more electronegative, which can pull the electron towards itself more. That's why these bonds are much more shorter than this one pz, which has less s character and less electronegative character also. Okay, so more or less we have already discussed these things, right, of VSEPR theory and how they determine the we can predict the molecular geometries with them. Now as I said that this VSEPR theory is mostly qualitative, right, and we cannot expect everything to come out like this, so there are some limitations also of this VSEPR theory. One of them is the structure. It cannot explain the structure of AC xenon hexafluoride, right? See, xenon hexafluoride, what do you expect? You will expect that Xc has 5s, 5p, 5d. So it is like this. So in excited state you need 6 electron pairs, right, to form 6 bonds. So in excited state you will have these p electrons will unpair and be promoted to d, right, forming a sp3d3, right, with one lone pair and 6 bond pairs. So you expect it to be something like this, isn't it? So trigonal, pentagonal bipyramid, but it is not the case. Experimentally it is found that XCF6 is mostly octahedral in structure, a distorted octahedron of course, with the lone pair sometimes is focusing through the edges and sometimes through the face of the octahedron. There are two types of things. So this is one of the limitations, and more limitations we already discussed that this is not qualitative. So with this we end our periodic properties module, and we'll start a next module next time.